all for coming today. I want to start by welcoming our host for this event from the Women's Guild. Anne, you want to introduce your crew?
Yes. This is a star cooking team. All Scottish food tonight. And Kate is our lead cook. She is wonderful, and she's going to tell you what the menu is.
Well, our entree is salmon poached in whiskey with a whiskey sauce. As side dishes, we have rumblebeetham, which you might know as cold cannon if you eat Irish food. We are also having barley with mushrooms. We have two types of scones. We have sticky toffee pudding. We have oatmeal cookies. Oh, and we have meat pies.
Yes. Oh,
right. The meat pies are half and half warm.
So we have a wonderful menu. Linda, she made the homemade.
This is a bad.
Shirley Mosley made the oatmeal cookies. Kate Mosley made all the rest. And here's your bartender, my husband Johnson.
Thank you, ladies, for all you do for us.
Oh, yeah. Who is the fastest chomper we've ever met.
Bon appetit.
Well, I am Todd Simmons. I'm executive director for the New Orleans Opera, and I want to start here at the end and just have each person involved with the cast introduce themselves, tell you what their role is in this production, and tell you a little bit about their history with this role.
I'm Lauren Meeker. I'm the stage director, and I'm very excited to be directing a full Lucia for the first time. I've choreographed one before, I've assisted on one before, and I've done a lot of individual scene work, but it's really nice to be able to be here doing the full piece with a very talented group of artists, so I think we're in for a real treat.
I'm Laura Clayton. I will be singing Lucia, and I started this role when I was about 20 or 21, so it's just a few years ago. And I've since done at least, I think, four or five different productions of it, very differing productions as well. So it's always a pleasure to come back to it and try to see what new things you can dig out of the score and dig out of myself and get feedback from the director and that sort of thing. And it's always a joy to come back to this gorgeous music and dig into it again and go, oh, this just fits me like a glove. Mm. So, that's my history with Lucia. Besides, I could tell a little anecdote. In one of my, actually the first time I did Lucia was in Israel, was in Tel Aviv. Mm. And we had a really cool setup where I was upstairs and I was looking over the body of Arturo when he was dead, when I killed him, and I lit candles around him. Problem is, it hadn't clued into me, I was having a soprano moment, and I had this extra long hair. You can hear it coming, can't you? So I lit the candles closest to me first, and then reached over and had during a shower. During a shower. And so I saw this, and I kind of went like that, and just kept singing. I heard this gasp from the audience, and I thought, God, they overreact. And so afterwards, they told me that there was like this plume that went up. And of course, it was not the fake hair that they had added in. It was my hair that burned. So anyhow, kind of a funny little side note. When you're lighting candles on stage, light the farthest ones away from you first.
You learn.
Yeah.
My name is William Burden, and I am singing the role of Edgardo, who is the man who is in love with Lucia, and whose heart is broken by her. And this is my second time singing this role. It's one of the greatest tenor roles in the repertoire, and so it's a real privilege to get to do it. And I guess the sort of special aspect to this particular production for me is that I have known Laura since pretty much when she began learning this role. And although we have had an opportunity over the years to perform a couple of times, it is always a pleasure to get to sing with dear friends and colleagues. And so this is a, thank you, Robert, a wonderful opportunity that I am cherishing.
Well, one of the reasons I jumped at this to be able to do it with Bill.
My name is Jordan Bish. I'm singing with Raimondo, the bass, and this is my fourth production of the show. It was one of my first big roles that I took on after I finished my young artist's work. And
this was about 4 days ago.
But no, it's a lot of fun to sing. It's one of my favorite parts, so I'm really looking forward to the performances.
Michael Chioli, I'm singing Enrico. This is, I believe it's my 13th production. I've done quite a few of these. I've done productions all across the world, and it's from traditional to non-traditional. Enrico is an interesting role. It's Cheryl Millens. I worked this role when I was probably 20 years old with Cheryl Millens, and he said, you know, be careful with this one, Michael, because this is more Verdi than it is Donizetti for the baritone, so be careful about that. And indeed, he was correct. Now that I'm 44, I think my first one when I was 22 when I was covering it in Houston Grand Opera, they never would have put me on, but I had to sing a lot of events where I sang the aria, and I sounded like a mosquito, but still. It's wonderful coming into the role now after singing some bigger repertoire. I've moved into sort of the bigger bel canto Verdi roles, and now coming back to Enrico is really wonderful. The character is complex, the music is wonderful, and I feel really lucky to be a part of such a talented group of singing actors, because in this opera, if you don't have people who pay attention to the text as well as the music, it doesn't work quite as well in my experience. And you are all in for a big treat with this cast, I can say that.
Well, I think you know my work. I'm conducting this production. Done at least 8 productions of Lucia, all different. Never, as Lauren likes to joke, Planet of the Apes playing tennis on the moon, but various gradations of departure from its historical setting, and we'll talk about that more in context. I think, as Michael's words would reflect, that as you mature in the art form of opera, you go from viewing the challenges of every style being the same to appreciating what each era brought in the way of advances, either vocally or orchestrally or dramatically, you know, getting rid of the subject matter of everything being about kings and queens of Europe or the issues of church and state and things like that, into the real human dilemma that music drama began to portray throughout the 19th century. And so when you put bel canto in its context, you're absolutely right. It's not just about the voice or just about the music. It's about the text. It's about the characterization presented in a very specific kind of musical language. And so I think our challenge is, as we've all, through coaching, through experience, through living with these pieces, began to see what drives the drama, what drives the musical momentum of the pieces. We learn to love what this language offers us, because I think we have such strong pillars that we look to. You say, well, here the titans of any given era are a Verdi and a Wagner, that kind of thing. To see what the evolution of the style is through Bellini, Donizetti, and Rossini, all of whom contributed to this, but then it began to be kind of encapsulated in the styles of Verdi, who became certainly the most celebrated in our era. So it's an interesting set of challenges, and I think creates an interesting set of discussions, and that is, how modern are these people? Not characters. I don't want to even talk about them in terms of characters, because that suggests that they are kind of within a clearly defined thing, but they're human beings. And the drama of Lucia di Lammermoor is a fascinating one, obviously it's centuries old. The drama of any interesting operatic character is a fascinating one. And so it's a question of the degree of revelation about their personal experience and intensity of that life or things of that nature. So with that intro, let me invite my colleagues to weigh in. Todd.
Well, next what I like to do is, what we always do is walk through the story, but since we've already spoken of the proverbial planet of the apes, why don't we address that to begin
first.
With?
Okay. Yeah. You know, I think as a stage director in collaboration with any opera company and certainly with a maestro, there's always a conversation about where do we want to set a piece, what are we trying to say with the piece, and there are a lot of influences that can go into that. And here, when Robert and I first started talking, we were looking at sort of the fabulous history that Lucia has had, specific even to New Orleans, knowing that it had its American premiere here, and that in fact the company has had a good history doing this piece, and I think most recently also in a traditional setting. So when our conversation started to deepen, we were looking for ways to be able to make this piece still resonate for a modern audience, without it feeling like it's a museum piece to be viewed from afar with characters and contexts that are not applicable to us somehow, or meant to be said even at a very basic level of, oh, well, that's a lovely sounding bel canto opera. Next. We were looking for a context that would really start to make it feel popular to today's audience and to all of you. And we started to talk about the 1910s and that particular era having a heavy amount of fascination in the world right now, especially in America. If you look at Downton Abbey season one, that's the 1910s. There are other things that are hot on the heels of that era, like Boardwalk Empire and some other that sort of pushes into the 20s. But this is an era that's hot within the industry right now that we're going to try and capitalize on. And what's also fantastic about the era of the 1910s is that it's enough of an update to make characterizations and choices within the piece relevant to us, but not so modern, I hope. But what we're finding in rehearsal is that it makes all of the vital issues to a family that's struggling politically, to a family that's struggling monetarily, to needing to be in a society where a woman very much is considered a pawn of the family to be able to be taken and said, you will marry this person at this time to help the family, and that it's not about love. So this era, the 1910s, seemed to be a setting, and keeping it in Scotland at that time period, seemed to be a setting that was giving us all of those fabulous things to play with. So that's where we've ultimately landed in terms of the concept for this production, and I think that's creating quite a healthy amount of dialogue and rehearsals about, okay, if we're not, for example, all having swords when we're at the contract signing, then what does that become, and how do we keep that context real, and how do we heighten the drama within our new setting? And I think we're finding some fruitful character conversations and some deep work within all of that. And it's producing some very exciting results.
Mm-hmm. Well, let us kind of start from the beginning of the opera. For those who don't know a lot about the opera, the plot of this story, why don't we start from the beginning, kind of walk us through the show and how your character, what happens?
Should I start and then we can kind of dovetail it piece by piece?
Exactly.
When the show opens, the first scene that we come to is out on the grounds of Ravenswood Castle. And what's important to sort of track throughout the opera is the fact that we're talking about three major Scottish families or clans. The Ravenswood Castle actually belongs to Edgardo Ravenswood. That's Bill's character. But it is currently inhabited by Lucy and Enrico's family. That's the Ashton clan. So what we learn and sort of need to know in terms of background is that, in fact, this land and these two families have been warring for centuries. And even if you look at the actual historical context, because this is a real historical family that existed, this fight and this fight over this territory has been going on since the 13th century. So it's very much like Romeo and Juliet, which was written in the 1500s. It's very much like American Hatfields and McCoys.
Mm-hmm.
So we learn that this is a family that's absolutely divided, that Lucy and Enrico Ashton is one family, and Edgardo Ravenswood is the other family. And the Ashtons are currently in control of the Ravenswood land. With me so far? Okay. So we're sitting in this castle, and men who are in Enrico's employment come rushing into the space at the command of the head of their guard, and that character's name is Normano. And Normano indicates that there has been somebody, some shadowy figure, skulking around the grounds who was not expected to be there. In this production, you will see Edgardo go past, so that we set up very early on that, in fact, yes, it is him on his family's grounds, traipsing through on his way to meet Lucia. And we learn in that first scene that the families are really at a crisis. They're in a very heightened state of hatred for each other. That's a very deep-seated issue that's rooted in Normano, who I think is very much like an Iago character, turning keys for Enrico and getting the families to clash. And so Normano sends his men out to be able to search for this shadowy figure. And as they make their way out, then in comes the first principal characters that we're really vocally introduced to, which is Enrico and Raimundo. You want to say a little bit about your context as you guys come in?
Well, I come in and the first line is, "You seem troubled." Which indeed I am. I'm very worried about the family. And it's really, you know, Donizetti, it's such a wonderful way that he sets this up. It's a really beautiful, wonderful recit. It's a great recit to sing, and it really just flies right into this amazing aria and cabaletta, which is kind of a tour de force for the baritone. It happens in the first 5 minutes of the opera. So lots of high notes and lots of, like, you know, energy, like a lot of testosterone energy. The aria and cabaletta, I'm basically saying, you know, my star is waning, the family's power politically is fading, and I need to do something to fix it. I find out, midst, that the men see him, and that's my deepest fear, is that it's his, he. I had suspected it. And he's sort of my biggest enemy. And I say, this will not be, this will not happen. She will not, you know, be involved with this person. I will extinguish their love with blood.
Yeah, so we learn through Enrico and the return of the
men. I'm very serious about it.
He's very serious about it. We learn with the return of the men that when they went out and searching that, in fact, they did find this figure, and a huntsman, a falconer, they say, in the woods, identified him as Edgardo. So that's what they get to say to Enrico when they come back, with hesitation in even telling this very volatile personality that, yes, in fact, his mortal enemy is the man who's been around. And then Normano turns that key and says, "I hate to break it to you, but not only is he, you know, threatening us and getting close and on the property, but, you know, he's been meeting with Lucia secretly many mornings, and that, in fact, the story goes that that she was walking with Elisa, and Edgardo saved her from a beast that was attacking, or a bull." And so, of course, they meet under heightened dramatic circumstances, and they've been seeing each other ever since.
The part that you don't see, that I say, but you don't actually see it, is that letters, I've been intercepting letters from him to her. Yeah.
That's later.
But that's, I know.
Later.
Yeah,
but we'll get there. Yeah. So we learn how volatile these two men are within that first context. We learn that the Ashton family, Enrico and Lucia's family, is in a very difficult position monetarily and politically, and that essentially being involved with their mortal enemy is not a good solution to any of those problems. And so that first scene ends with Enrico threatening to essentially destroy him and destroy his family. the next time we see them, which is what Michael's referring to, several months have passed. And we're... Oh, oh my gosh, I just jumped a whole scene. I'm so sorry. That's his next scene.
Two scenes.
So we get to, the next scene that we see is deeper into those woods. The reason that Edgardo's been skulking around is because he, in fact, has asked Lucia to meet him. That's the next scene that we see. Thank you. Sorry about that.
So I come in with my handmaid, Elisa, and he's not there yet. And so, of course, I have to sing an aria. you know, an aria and cabaletta. And so she said, oh, why are you looking so strangely at that fountain there? I said, well, let me tell you the ghost story about this fountain. Not only is it said to be haunted, but I saw the ghost. So, and we'll see. I think we'll be playing, without giving too much away, we'll be playing it that I am just trying to scare her, and that it's, you know, but I'm obviously a very fantastical person and find these kind of gothic stories to be very attractive and very exciting. And so she says, oh, that's a bad omen, you know, you shouldn't be seeing him, we shouldn't be here. And I say, no, he's the light of my life, and he's the only good thing going for me right now. I swore eternal love to him. So then he shows up.
He arrives with news that he's going to actually leave Scotland because he is trying to develop some new political allies to perhaps gain back some of the stature that his family has lost, but has asked, or is asking Lucia, or telling her that he plans to first speak to her brother to try and patch things up a little bit and say, look, we're in love with each other, we want to make this work, I'm going to go and try and shore up some new allies, and won't that be all right? And she knows at this point that he is out to kill me, frankly, and doesn't want me to do it, and I assume that she doesn't love me as much as she had professed, and that, anyway, through the course of a very beautiful duet, they do profess their love for one another, and actually sort of symbolically marry one another with the exchange of rings, and Edgardo goes off to...
And I say, write me every day, please!
Right.
Then we get
the
to
letters.
The letters
get intercepted.
Yeah.
So she thinks that he has not... been faithful to her while he's been away, because she has not ever received letters that he has written. He also has not received any letters from her, because all of the letters have been intercepted.
It's for the good of the family, trust me.
And in the meantime, Enrico has also arranged an advantageous marriage for Lucia.
That's right.
Michael, do you want to talk a little bit about even just that first visit when we see you with Normano and what you're setting up, that's not only the intercepting of the letters, but you sort of go one step farther, don't you, in order to twist your sister's fate in terms of letter writing? With the forged letter?
Normano, the scene begins and he says, Lucia will soon arrive, will soon be here. And I say, you know, I'm trembling as I wait, because deep down inside, you know, when you play a character that's sort of perceived as evil, you can never play evil. You have to play a character as a human being, and someone who is involved in a situation where you believe that this is really the best thing for the family. And I do honestly believe that. I mean, the many times that I've done this role, I don't really... He does some unfortunate things.
But he
feels like he's... It's a little misogynistic in the way that he's like, well, she just doesn't understand. Like, you know, she's a woman, she just doesn't understand the political ramifications of what's going on with the family. And it's interesting in opera, there's sort of a a tradition in opera you find throughout the 18th and 19th century operas. And I intercept the letters, and in that duet, oh God, that's my favorite duet. It's, honestly, it's my favorite piece in the whole opera, is this wonderful duet, and it's multifaceted, and Lucia comes in, Arturo, we write a fake letter.
Yeah.
And it sort of sets up the whole scene.
And it says that he's been unfaithful.
Says that he's been unfaithful.
From him saying, you've been unfaithful.
Basically,
no.
I don't love you anymore.
Or something, yeah.
You know, because I've intercepted the letters. She hasn't heard from him. I finally fake a letter. And, you know, I'm really torn. I feel like I'm torn. Like, I don't want to give this to her. Like, I hope that she'll just decide to do the right thing.
Yeah.
But she forces my hand in the duet.
Yeah. So they've been pushing this other guy, Arthur.
Right.
Arthur Bucklaw, which is the third family.
Third family.
The first.
And so he obviously, you know, has a lot of money, has a lot of political power and whatnot, and we need all of the above. And, but of course I'm steadfastly refusing. So in the meantime, months have passed, and so I've, you know, been waiting steadfast with my little ring from my boyfriend, thinking, we're married.
It's a very nice ring,
waiting
actually.
For him to come. We'll see, it's familiar. It's familiar. In rehearsals, actually, it's been a hair tie.
A hair tie.
So we're exchanging hair ties.
At least spare no expense.
But
she walks in sort of very distraught, and I say to her, you know, I hope that I see you on this wonderful day where you're going to save the family in better spirits. And she's, you know,
not about to do that.
She's not going to happen.
You know, this might be a good point for me to introduce Raimondo, who can talk about his role, because Michael's talking about the political pressures and financial and family issues, and as would have been befitting any great estate, they have their own chaplain. And so the man of God in this opera is the character Raimondo. And we see him in the first scene when the men are pursuing whoever it is that has invaded the estate. And then this leads to what is possibly his most critical function in the drama. And so, Jordan, with that introduction, why don't you flesh out Raimondo for us?
I think it's interesting what Michael said, in that antagonists can't play themselves as villains because they have very thought-out, reasonable ideas. And in a way, they really do. And especially in this show, there isn't necessarily a character like Enrico saying, I want to do my sister harm. It's very typical what he's trying to do for her. And Raimondo is in a situation where he's watching these events unfold, and he's seeing things getting worse and worse. He's just seen Lucy and Enrico's parents have died, most recently the mother, and so she's still in mourning, and maybe even Enrico is too, who knows. But he's seen, you know, that tragedy befall the family. He sees all this political turmoil about to come up, and he sees that the family is in jeopardy. So I think that the idea that Lucy should marry someone that's advantageous for the family, that's a reasonable idea. At the same time, he also wants to give Lucia some time to deal with the loss of her mother before they rush her into an arranged marriage. He finds out that she's already in love with someone else, and that she wants to marry him. And so, when he's away in France, she's writing these letters. They're being intercepted by her brother and his minions. And I come to realize that that's happening. And so I come to Lucia and I say, you know, write a letter and give it to me. And I'm going to send it with my own mail that he won't search. And then we'll see if we can get it to him. It doesn't come back. I send off the letter and I get no response. And months later, there's no response from him. And so I believe after Enrico produces a fake letter that's supposed to be from Edgardo from France, saying, I have another lover, I renounce you, this is over. After I see that, and along with not hearing back from the letter I wrote, I assume that letter is true. and so I lay on top, and on top of what Rika was saying, I come from a different perspective and say, this is the best thing for the family, for you to move on. This other guy is unfaithful to you, you should marry this other man, and you know, it will be in the best interest of the family and for yourself, and you can sacrifice this particular piece of happiness in your life for something so much greater.
And you will be rewarded in heaven. You'll be rewarded for that.
If not on earth, then you'll be rewarded in heaven. Yeah. Right.
I love the two juxtaposition of his character, who's sort of like the angel on one shoulder of me, and Arturo, Romano, who's sort of like the devil on the other side, who's saying, do this. He's like, keep the peace.
That, of course, is Casey Candibat.
Yeah.
Who can't be with us today.
Right.
Yeah.
But that duet, musically, I've always found... It was interesting. I have this big aria, and then there's these other scenes that are also arias that, you know, sort of like bang, bang, bang.
Yeah.
And then you have this duet. This duet sort of like, for me, it's where the opera really takes its footing. And it really musically takes its footing there. The arias are wonderful, and they're spectacular. And musically, they're very strong. And in the context of the piece, they work beautifully. But somehow, this duet in the composition and how it was written is so beautiful.
And I think it's because it's not about display.
Yeah.
Mm. It is, you know, everything, the structure of bel canto is such that you have aria and cabaletta, and in between something interesting happens. And the repeat of the aria invites readdressing it musically, making it different. Often it uses the same text, often identical text, to carry it to that extreme. And so consequently, if dramatic narrative pauses for musical considerations, then how do you make it interesting? How do you engage the audience? And so the tradition's built up of adding ornamentation, making the music slightly different, more embellished, enriching, exciting, until it became truly about almost who can do as much with those opportunities musically as vocal capabilities allowed.
Well, I think that also brings into the question of how structure in opera will gives us a certain assurance and whatnot. If you listen to something that by Mozart, for example, and you have, you know, the ABA,
right, same problem.
You end up coming back to music that you've already heard once, so it becomes more familiar, and it becomes, I think, in a way, reassuring for the audience. So even if we're adding ornaments, you're like, oh, okay, I know that, and you've heard it before, and it's a great way for us to be able to intensify or add a kind of twist to what you've already heard, so you don't have to think, oh, what is she saying, because we've already heard those words, we know what that is structurally, and so then you can enjoy it in a way a lot more because you already know that. It's the same thing that happens when I've sung, like, Gilda, for example, in Rigoletto, that when the audience hears bum 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 ba da da, they go, ah, because they know it. And it's the same thing here, that something that repeats itself in the second, in these cabalettas, it intensifies not only for us because we're adding ornaments and those sort of things, but also for the audience because they're familiar with that material already, and so then they can enjoy it without wondering what's going to be next. You wonder what's going to be next in the sense of what are the ornaments, but not so much about the structure. And I think that's very interesting for the structure.
Well, and I think those are beautiful points. It's there are relationships, though I wouldn't carry them to huge extent, between the art of the castrati and where we ended up with bel canto in 1835 when this piece premiered. Because they were celebrated for their ability to have vocal agility that was of exceptional nature. And men with playing female parts with the power of a male voice was the kind of unique feature. But back to the duet at hand, what's beautiful is it's, and I think Verdi borrowed heavily from Lucia di Lammermoor, If you look at a couple of the brother sister scenes, they are not terribly far removed from what we get with the father and daughter scenes in La Traviata. And that is a kind of unity of their singing lines, not competing interests, certainly personalities, but musically true duetting.
Right.
And that's maybe, Michael, why it appeals to you so fundamentally, because it's not so much about technique as relationship and the beauty of the line, whether in sixth or thirds or however it so be. And it's quite eloquent, and I always never come to the opening of Soprio nel Pianto, where she sings, and it's just straight out of Mozart. I mean, Mozart died, 45 years earlier, but 44 to be exact. But the similarities are so there, the eloquence and the simplicity and the power of simple chord progressions and a beautiful melodic line. So, yeah, that's a great, great, great duet.
Yeah.
Because it is so intensely personal.
Right, right. Brother and sister.
Yeah. And it's different, I guess, than being out in the yard singing the ornamentation of the Cavalletto of Regnava nel Silenzio, which is kind of filling the heavens with the ecstasy of your joy at meeting the one that you love. You know, it's youthful, it's vibrant, it should have a certain kind of brillante quality. This is after a brother and sister have just stared each other down, and he's saying, if you don't help us, my head goes to the axeman. And, you know, let me share that family trouble with you.
Yeah.
And now let's sing. You know? But instead of two girls out in the yard and one saying, now be careful, you know, this is dangerous. But she's saying, my heart just is supercharged with ecstasy.
Yeah.
That's the first art.
Yeah, kind of thing. And so it's that kind of difference. So when we talk about just pretty music, you know, bel canto, beautiful singing, that's so utterly all-encompassing, it doesn't touch the complexities.
Yeah.
So, go ahead.
So if we get back to the story, so I have this duet with my brother where I'm mad at him, then he tells me that, my boyfriend has been unfaithful, and so I get sad, and then he comforts me, and then we get angry with each other again, because he says, oh, great, okay, good, well, you know, I've been comforting you, and you're feeling sad, well, your new husband is arriving.
She's like, what's that noise? No, like, that's the announcement of your new husband.
Yeah, he's coming, and all the guests are about to arrive. Oh. And so we get angry with each other again, of course, because I'm like, no!
I say to her, if you betray me, I'll haunt your dreams.
Yeah.
Yes.
So, and my thought is just, you know, heaven open up and just, you know, take
swallow
me out.
Swallow me up.
Yeah. And at that point, our lovely priest arrives and tells me the whole thing of, oh, you didn't get any letters back even when I sent one. So I think he has been unfaithful. And I said, well, what about, we exchanged rings, we're married. And he said, well, that doesn't count in the eyes of God, so you need to do what you need to do. So I'm totally beaten down by this point. And at that point, when they, you know, when we leave the stage, the entire stage is taken over already for the wedding. So I'm being let off just to get dressed and turn around and come back.
Yeah.
So it's through the motivations not only of feeling family pressure with Enrico, but then also
church pressure.
The church pressure and the knowledge that Edgardo presumably has been unfaithful. That allows essentially the priest to be able to say, okay, we're good to go. And her text does say, guide me. You know, I can't resist any longer. I'll do it. And that allows the guests to come flying in, the contract to be signed, and it gets us into the next scene.
Yeah.
So
in very typically operatic fashion, everything moves forward to the actual signing of the contract. Lucia is now married to this next guy, and at that very moment, Edgardo bursts into the room, having returned from France,
10 minutes beforehand,
and basically lays claim to her at that point. Although it's too late, we already have a paper, and it's already signed. he then feels completely betrayed. And in some of the most famous music from the piece, this big ensemble that happens, there's a sextet where everyone sort of is experiencing for a moment the individual emotions that they are all flooded with, and then the scene erupts into this explosion of, you know, it's all too late, and you signed this, and how could you do it, and you broke my heart, but you made this promise, and it didn't happen, and get out or we're going to kill you, and we'll kill me anyway because my life is over, and he runs out, curtain, end of the first act.
Yeah.
And so you must come back because you know that incredible things are going to happen during the course of the interview.
Of course, he never asked the right question. The only question he asked me is this,
did you sign this contract?
Is this your signature?
It's her.
And I'm like,
That's all I ever get to say.
So nobody ever asks me the right question. Yeah.
So that's a little bit of
pressured to sign this. But instead, he flies off the handle because he thinks, "Oh, you're just unfaithful." So.
But it does lead us to something that is very special, and that is the wedding celebration that follows the exit of Edgardo, and that is, of course, leading us to the mad scene. And when you say mad scene in opera, I think every opera lover immediately shifts to Lucia first.
Yeah.
So when we, as we commonly say, it is the most famous mad scene in opera, that's justifiably true, although mad scenes were all the rage in the early 19th century. I mean, there are plenty of examples of characters in which this phantasmagorical kind of experience became commonplace. They just were not set with quite the beauty and the facility of Donizetti. So who wants to talk about the mad scene?
Well, to get us into Lucia's entrance, the scene starts presumably later on in the evening. The contract has been signed. The guests are all still in the home, and they're celebrating. Right, and they're celebrating whilst the husband and Lucia are upstairs, presumably consummating the marriage. And it's in the midst of these festivities that Raimondo appears, and he stops the action and tells the guests.
I stopped the party, and I let everyone know that I heard someone scream in terror from the bridal chamber, and came rushing in to find that Lucia was standing over Arturo's dead body, clutching a dagger that was covered in blood, and talking gibberish. And so I came running out in panic, and I let everyone in the party know that that happened, and that she has lost her mind.
You just didn't ask the right question.
I didn't ask the right question. I didn't ask her, hey, did you lose your mind? How many fingers am I holding up? And full of remorse and desperation, I of course sing a prayer that vengeance doesn't fall down upon us. And just as that's finishing, she comes in at the top of the staircase and does her thing.
Somewhat imagining that I'm marrying the right man, so Edgardo's kind of mixed up, and reality keeps coming back through because I'm all bloody and. There are, of course, many, many, many different ways we could do this. There are many different choices, the ways you can read the music and how you can think of what her internal monologue is, or how you follow from one disjunct thought to the next. Because I think even people with mental problems don't just jump from one thing to another. There is an internal logic to what they are thinking. Even if you follow, the person down the street that you say, oh, he's crazy, whatever. There is some kind of logic to what's going on, at least in their head. And so we've been trying to find what those moments are and how I'm dealing with different things. So for us, at least, I'm coming in and out of reality, that I'm, trying to go back to my happy place. My happy place. Oh, okay, my happy place is when we were together, and that's what I keep trying to hold back on to. So I keep seeing my fantasy wedding, my lovely wedding where I married the right man. And but reality keeps coming through. So
And so in the context of this, I think defining what mad means or how a person gets pushed to that point, and how this pressure from society, the pressure from her brother, the destruction of her love has really left her isolated. And we also play Arturo, in an arrogant fashion as well, so that it's yet one more man who is taking advantage of her. So it should feel like her world to get her into that mad scene has left her with no choice but to escape essentially the most horrifying situation any woman could imagine, being forced to marry and sleep with a man who you've had no relationship with whatsoever, and that's what dives us into the mad scene. And within that, making those choices within that context, her brother then enters and says, is this true? Yeah. Has she gone mad? And discovers Lucia in this continued state of sometimes recognizing the characters for who they are in front of her, and sometimes slipping out of that reality.
And I realize, possibly the error of my ways. And
possibly.
And I ask God for forgiveness. Say, God, what have I done?
That's better.
So by the end of this scene, I won't give away all of the things that we're playing with and exploring with, but by the end of the scene, she is lost to madness or lost to death is where the direction that we're headed in. And that
basically said, just pour your tears over my grave, and at least I'll find. I'll be waiting for you, honey, up in heaven.
So then we go to the final scene, which is back out on the grounds beyond the castle near the centuries-old Ravenswood tombs, where we discover Edgardo.
Who has gone to that place basically to end his life because he has nothing left to live for. He is the last of the Ravenswoods, and no longer has either title or property, and has lost the only thing that is important to him, which is the love of Lucia. So, faced with that, he plans to end his own life, only to discover that he hears people leaving the castle after this event, and it is determined that he understands then that Lucia is dying, and so he tries to get back to see her one last time, but the bell tolls that indicates that she has died, and Raimondo tells him she's no longer with us, and it truly is a tragedy in all ways.
Those two scenes are like the the way it's constructed musically is so genius. She has this amazing sort of lengthy virtuosic scene, and it ends, and then he comes in and has the most heart-wrenching, gorgeous sort of crying sounds, and it's magic. Yeah, it's so magic.
And it's a story that we know.
It's the aria every baritone wishes they had to sing.
But what makes it so relevant and what makes it so powerful for an audience is that it is indeed a story we know. It's Romeo and Juliet. Mm-hmm. It's any of the great tragic love stories from throughout all of literature and all of storytelling. It is the most human story of not unrequited, but certainly lost love, and the tragedy of that.
And the tenor gets to end the opera.
Which is really how it should be anyway. But
sometimes back in the olden days, a lot of times they would end the opera
with
Manzi, and that was it.
Yeah.
I'm sure that was. Those were some angry
tenors. Yeah,
no
pressure on
tenor.
Then, no.
Yeah, I think it depended on the tenor.
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
So, God, did you kill yourself after all, or
you're gonna have to come?
it
is tragic.
What Laura is saying addresses a kind of a basic theatrical concept, and that is end with this climactic moment. Same thing happened with Mozart's Don Giovanni, you know, for almost a century, we came to the Don Giovanni being dragged off into the flames of hell, great ringing D minor chord, and the curtain came down. Who said, okay,
justice. Like happy endings?
Yes, it's like a happy ending. Or in this case, the sensational vocalism of the man scene was the highlight of the evening. But the genius of these great composers is that there is a denouement. There is a resolution. Otherwise, we all leave, and then somebody will think driving home. I wonder what happened to Edgardo.
I wonder what happened to Mazzetto. Nobody wonders what happened to
Mazzetto. Yeah. And nobody cares.
Nobody cares what happened to Mazzetto.
But see, it's also, I think that this also speaks very strongly to the importance of understanding that bel canto, in its greatest sense, is not just about beautiful singing. Right. It is about the human story being told through beautiful singing. And that's why this story has to be resolved for all of the characters in the story. Otherwise, we haven't, the job isn't finished. And it isn't just, or we could do it in concert. And then, it would have a different impact on you.
And the one character I've always wondered about in that context, Bill, is Enrico.
Yeah. Yeah,
Lucia's dead, Edgardo's dead, Arturo's dead.
Spoiler.
Well, I think
spoiler.
We know.
Spoiler, we know.
Oh, I'm sorry. They were all going to dinner.
But I think we can take from the context of the story that all of the machinations that he had put into place to try and sort of solidify his positions have been lost.
Yeah,
and the fact that Arturo was murdered in his home is not going to go well for him.
I have to live with that. I have to live with the fact.
Yeah, but I mean, I think there will be much stronger ramifications for you politically because Arturo was murdered in your home.
Yeah. By your sister.
We can only hope that the consequences for him would be bad.
No!
Oh, yes, the ends do not justify the means.
But that is the continuing story, and that is that, I mean, if you go to the original material, we're talking about the era of, or references to William and Mary and these bloody wars that he's fending off. And so his story continues after the final curtain goes down. Everyone else has departed the scene in one way or another. But I think the principle we're trying to talk about is that the creative genius of someone like Donizetti knew that need for denouement, for bringing it to closure, for letting us all depart the theater, realizing just like Romeo and Juliet, okay, it opens with a famous prologue about two families at war and the consequences. In the end, we see it, and we are brought back to the prologue, you see. And in this case, there's something similar, not exactly the same, but something very, very similar.
Right.
So, anyway.
Well, with that, we're already past 5, and so I know the ladies are going to be wanting us to come in there. So I want to thank the panel for coming today. I'm sure if you have other questions, you can ask them while we're getting our little snacks. Panel, thank you all very much.
Thank you.